parties urged to stand firm against unequal treatment of minorities and Islamophobia. ASEAN's neutrality vital to boost regional investment. Good afternoon and Salam Alaikum Madani. This is World Today and I'm Otto Othman. Now, all parties in the world, including Muslims and non-Muslims, must voice out their firm stance against the unequal treatment received by the minorities. Prime Minister Datuk Seri Anwar Ibrahim stressed that Islamophobia is one of the many arising issues repeatedly faced by this particular group of people.
I do, empathize with them, their predicament. And I think it is the role of not only Muslim countries, but general countries all over the world to just express their disgust and protest against any sort of unfair treatment of minorities all over. We are as concerned about our minorities here. And I think on such a moral high ground, we continue to express our views.
Speaking during an exclusive interview with US-based broadcaster and political commentator Mehdi Hassan, the premier urged the international community to put an end to the widespread discriminatory practices.
We have to move on.
The prime minister also commented on the Israeli mass killings of the Palestinians in Gaza. Datuk Seri Anwar strongly criticized the Western countries for their perceived hypocrisy in handling the Gaza conflict.
The sheer hypocrisy of many of the countries in the West to condone this, to me, is shocking, it's appalling. And therefore, we have to speak up. I mean, Malaysia is a small country, but I think it is a voice of conscience and represents the vast majority of Malaysians.
The Prime Minister clarified Malaysia's position on the matter, focusing on the Palestinian issue and the actions of Israel. 1 year after the Israel-Hamas war escalated on 7th October last year, Gaza is unrecognizable and its residents are exhausted by displacement and shortages with no end in sight. After a year of war, Gaza City was barely recognizable, ravaged by relentless airstrikes and fighting. Residents walked along sand-covered streets stripped of pavements, with buildings either destroyed or left without facades, while piles of rubble littered the roads. With fuel in short supply and expensive, car traffic was almost non-existent. Most people walked, cycled, or used donkey carts. The United Nations said 92% of Gaza's road and more than 84% of its health facilities have been damaged or destroyed in the war. It added about 90% of the population have been displaced at least once. Israel's military offensive in Gaza has killed at least 41,909 people, most of them civilians. Hamas' armed wing vowed to keep fighting, with it described as a long war of attrition. The United States has warned Israel not to attack Beirut Airport or the roads leading to it, as the Israeli army launched an intensive offensive against Hezbollah in the south of the Lebanese capital. Now, State Department spokesman Matthew Miller said it is very important that not only the airport be open, but the roads to the airport be accessible so that American citizens and other nationals who want to leave can get out of the country. The Israeli Air Force carried out a strike in the southern suburbs of Beirut near the international airport. For the past week, the United States have been chartering near-daily flights to get its citizens and their families out of the country as the conflict between Israel and Iran-backed Lebanese group Hezbollah escalates. Miller said some 900 people have taken the flights so far, though he added that none of them were fully booked. The U.S. is also reserving seats on commercial flights that continue to operate. Ukrainian forces have struck a large oil terminal overnight on the occupied Crimean Peninsula, as Russia claimed to the capture of another village in East Ukraine. Kyiv has ramped up strikes targeting Russia's energy sector in recent months, aiming to dent revenues used by Moscow to fund its invasion, now grinding through its third year. Russian-installed authorities in Crimea said a fire had broken out at an oil facility in the Black Sea port town of some 70,000 people and that there were no casualties. Ukraine insists the strikes are fair retaliation for Russian attacks on its own energy infrastructure that have plunged millions into darkness. Ukraine also said at least 5 civilians were killed by Russian attacks, including a strike on a civilian ship in the port of Odessa, as well as in the east and the south of the country. Russia's defense ministry, meanwhile, claimed the capture of a village in eastern Ukraine close to the strategically important city of Pokrovsk. The ministry said it captured the village of Grodivka, a settlement in the Donetsk region near Pokrovsk, as Russian troops close in on the key logistics hub. The settlement, with an estimated pre-war population of around 2,000, is the latest in a series of towns in the Donetsk region to have fallen to Russian forces as they push towards Pokrovsk. Two Chinese nationals and several Pakistanis were killed in an attack in Pakistan's southern port city of Karachi. Several others were also injured in the attack. The Chinese embassy in Pakistan confirmed that the attack happened at about 11 p.m. local time on Sunday when a convoy from the Port Qasim Electric Power Company was attacked near Jinnah International Airport in Karachi. The Chinese embassy and consulate in Pakistan strongly condemned the act, expressed deep condolences to the victims of the two countries. The Chinese missions in Pakistan have inundated emergency response work, requiring Pakistan to do its best to treat the injured, conduct a thorough investigation of the attack, and severely punish the perpetrators. The banned outfit, Balochistan Liberation Army, has claimed responsibility for the attack through a statement on social media platform. Kazakhstan is one step closer to building its first ever nuclear power plant after a majority of voters backed the plan in a referendum despite a vocal anti-nuclear camp in the Central Asian Republic. Citing preliminary results, news agency Kazinform reported that some 71.1% of citizens voted in favor of plans to build a nuclear power station on Lake Balkhash near the former capital Almaty in the southeast of the country. Some 63% of 7.8 million eligible voters cast their ballots on Sunday, meaning the referendum was valid. Despite boasting large oil and gas reserves, Kazakhstan has been struggling with energy supply issues, and proponents of the nuclear plans have been calling for the construction of a plant for years, pointing to the country's uranium deposits. The government, led by President Kasym-Jomart Tokayev, is in favor of building a nuclear plant, with Tokayev hailing the referendum as historic when casting his vote. Ahead of the vote, the government has already mulled awarding a construction contract to foreign companies, including the Chinese plant operator CNNC, South Korea's KNHP, the French EDF, and Russia's Rosatom. ASEAN must maintain its neutrality in the face of global geopolitical tensions to stimulate foreign investments in the region. The Minister of Investment, Trade and Industry, Tengku Dato' Sri Zafrul Tengku Abdul Aziz, emphasized that the bloc's inclusivity and openness should serve as key selling points to attract investments while also stressing the importance of sustainability. Tengku Dato' Sri Zafrul said ASEAN trades and maintains friendships with all European countries, the West, and BRICS nations such as China and Russia. Despite global economic and geopolitical uncertainties, he noted that ASEAN continues to attract significant investments, even as global foreign direct investments decline. He said ASEAN is bucking the trend, which is a positive sign. However, there is another issue regarding the possibility of tariffs being imposed to protect certain markets. He said this is why ASEAN must continue dialogues with other blocs, particularly through multilateral platforms such as the World Trade Organization. Thailand's Prime Minister Prayuttong Tan Shinawat said the regional bloc, ASEAN, must play a key role in ending the protracted civil war in Myanmar. Now, Myanmar has been in turmoil since February 2021, when its military ousted an elected civilian government, sparking protests that have turned into an armed rebellion against the ruling junta. Prayuttong said ASEAN must play an important role in bringing peace back to Myanmar as soon as possible. She noted that Thailand will work with Malaysia, next year's ASEAN chair, to use diplomatic means to resolve the conflict, underscoring what may be a renewed effort by the bloc to push for resolution. So far, a peace effort by ASEAN, known as the Five-Point Consensus, has made scant progress since its unveiling in April 2021, despite repeated calls for dialogue. Myanmar's junta has refused to engage in talks with its rivals, calling them terrorists bent on destroying the country. The grinding conflict, which has left a third of Myanmar's 55 million people in need of humanitarian aid, will be high on the agenda as the ASEAN summits in Laos. Vietnamese Minister of Planning and Investment Nguyen Chi Dong said the country must strive to achieve gross domestic product GDP growth of 7.6% to 8% in the fourth quarter to realize the whole year's target of 7% or more. He emphasized that the two major cities of Hanoi and Ho Chi Minh City need to further promote their leading role and strive to achieve higher growth rates in the fourth quarter to help the country's growth exceed 7% for the whole year. The ministry proposed 10 groups of key tasks and solutions to accelerate growth, including production and business recovery after Typhoon Yagi, grabbing opportunities from year-end and Lunar New Year shopping trends. According to the General Statistics Office, Vietnam's GDP posted a 7.4% year-on-year growth in the third quarter and a 6.82% growth in the first 9 months of this year. Former Philippines President Rodrigo Duterte has registered his candidacy to run for mayor of the southern city of Davao in midterm polls due to be held next year. Davao is the family stronghold of Duterte, who as president launched a deadly drug war in 2016 that is subject of local and international investigations. His decision to run for mayor follows a bitter public falling out with the family of Philippines President Ferdinand Marcos ahead of presidential elections in 2028. His running mate will be his son and incumbent Davao mayor Sebastian Duterte, and he said he plans to make Davao better than yesterday. The former president's decision to run is seen as a move to galvanize support for his daughter Sara, who is widely expected to run for president in 2028. The 2025 midterm vote is crucial for both the Duterte and the Marcos families as they seek to shore up their support bases before that race. Still ahead, Tunisia's president wins a landslide second term. Kais Saied has been re-elected president of Tunisia with 90.69% of votes cast, though low turnout reflected widespread discontent in the cradle of the Arab Spring pro-democracy uprising. Saied won Sunday's vote by a landslide with 2.4 million votes, but with turnout at only 28.8% of nearly 10 million eligible voters. His imprisoned rival, Ayachi Zamel, received just 7.3%, and third candidate, Zawahir Magzawi, only 1.9%. 3 years after Saied made a sweeping power grab, rights groups fear his re-election will entrench his grip on the only democracy to emerge from the 2011 protests. Critics said the low turnout reflected widespread disillusionment with the election. After longtime dictator Zine El Abidine Ben Ali was ousted in 2011, Tunisia prided itself on being the birth birthplace of the regional revolts against authoritarianism that became known as the Arab Spring. But the North African country's path changed dramatically after Saïd was elected in 2019 with 73% of the vote. 2 years later, he dissolved parliament and later rewrote the constitution. Sunday's turnout was the lowest rate recorded in a Tunisian presidential election after Ben Ali's ouster. The mayor of Chilpancingo in Guerrero, Mexico, was killed just 6 days after taking office. The governor of the state of Guerrero said the killing of Alejandro Arcos aroused the anger of many. The Institutional Revolutionary Party denounced the crime as cowardly and demanded justice. The Attorney General's office informed that an investigation has been opened into the murder of Arcos. The state often experiences violence following territorial disputes between drug cartels. Arcos was elected in June as a representative of an opposition coalition that included the Institutional Revolutionary Party. Following his assassination, the party denounced the crime as cowardly and called for justice. The killing was the latest in a series of deadly attacks on politicians in the violence-plagued Latin American country. Clashes broke out in the capital of Albania between police and opposition protesters who are seeking the resignation of longtime leftist Prime Minister Edi Rama. 10 officers were injured during the clashes. A few thousand people gathered in Tirana for demonstrations organized by the country's right-wing opposition. Scuffles first broke out in front of the government building when demonstrators tried to break through a police cordon and some of them threw Molotov cocktails. The crowd then moved towards the headquarters of Rama's Socialist Party, where more Molotov cocktails were thrown, setting the entrance door on fire. The protesters, who want Rama to step down and a caretaker government to take over until next year's parliamentary elections, also targeted the Interior Ministry headquarters and the City Hall with Molotov cocktails. Police deployed in large numbers used tear gas in a bid to disperse the crowd moving towards the parliament. Police urged the demonstrators to stop attacking them and state institutions, warning that measures were being taken to identify those involved in the attacks. 4 children aboard a school bus in Northern Ireland, which overturned in a crash, required hospital treatment, while others suffered minor injuries. The Northern Ireland Ambulance Service said it had responded to the major incident near a village east of Belfast on the eastern coast of the UK territory. Initial reports indicated that approximately 70 people were on board the bus. This figure, however, had been revised to 43 and a driver. The Northern Ireland Ambulance Service said that it had sent multiple resources to the scene, including various medical responders. Robert Adair, a local council, said the school bus involved had been transporting students from nearby Strangford College. According to its website, the facility educates children aged 11 to 18. Increasingly intense floods and droughts are a distress signal of what is to come as climate change makes the planet's water cycle ever more unpredictable. The UN's World Meteorological Organization Secretary General Celeste Saulo said the world receives distress signals in the form of increasingly extreme rainfall, floods and droughts, which wreak a heavy toll on lives, ecosystems and economies. She noted that the heating up of the Earth's atmosphere had made the water cycle more erratic and unpredictable. Last year was the hottest on record, with high temperatures and widespread dry conditions producing prolonged droughts. There were also many floods around the world. These extreme events were influenced in part by naturally occurring climate conditions, including La Nina and El Nino weather phenomenon, apart from human-induced climate change. Water is either too abundant or insufficient, plunging many countries into increasingly difficult situations. In addition to curbing the man-made greenhouse gas emissions that cause global warming, the World Meteorological Organization wants the world's fresh water resources to be monitored better so early warning systems can reduce the damage to people and wildlife. Hurricane Milton exploded in strength to become a potentially catastrophic Category 5 storm bound for Florida, threatening the U.S. state with a second ferocious hurricane in as many weeks. Milton rapidly intensified the highest category on a scale of 5, triggering evacuation orders and warnings of savage conditions on Florida's west coast. Communities hit by Hurricane Helene, which slammed Florida late last month, raced to remove debris that could become dangerous projectiles as Milton barrels in. The National Hurricane Center said the storm's maximum sustained winds were near 285 kilometers per hour. Rainfall of 25 centimeters are expected to cause severe flash flooding. Florida authorities had issued mandatory evacuation orders for areas including some parts of Tampa, a metropolitan area of more than 3 million people that could take a direct hit. Governor Ron DeSantis declared 51 of Florida's 67 counties under a state of emergency, saying that Milton will remain a hurricane at some level as it passes through the state and exits on its east coast. Next up in sports, Harimau Malaya facing difficulties to secure Tier 1 friendly match. Kicking off our sports segment this afternoon, the Football Association of Malaysia, FAM, admits it is facing difficulties in securing another Tier 1 friendly match for the national team during the FIFA international match window from 7th to 15th October. FAM Deputy President Dato' Muhammad Yusof Mahadi revealed that many higher-ranked teams had shown interest in holding friendly matches with the Harimau Malaya squad, but they had other commitments.
Pasukan membuat persediaan masing-masing. Jadi kepentingan pasukan tu mungkin apa menyebabkan mereka bukan menolak tu perkara tak bermain, mungkin dia ada komitmen lain yang terpaksa mereka ni untuk kepentingan pasukan mereka. Jadi kita pun faham masalah itu sebab kita nampak sukar untuk mendapat pasukan-pasukan ini dan sampai pasukan yang bawah kita pun kita nak dapat pun sukar.
The national team's intention to play two Tier 1 friendly matches this month has not materialized. Instead, the team will face a top club side for a Tier 2 international match in New Zealand this Friday. Paumati Vicente's squad will then face the New Zealand national team in a Tier 1 international match at North Harbour Stadium, Auckland, next Monday. Meanwhile, the Harimau Malaya and the national under-23 football team will not be privatized. Instead, the FAM will form a new unit dedicated to specifically monitor the performance and management of national football teams. Dato' Muhammad Yusof said the idea for the formation of the unit was proposed by the Johor Regent Tunku Mahkota Ismail during a meeting with the Prime Minister Dato' Sri Anwar Ibrahim. He added that reason for the unit is the need for specialization to take care of the welfare and performance of national team players to ensure they improve. The funds for this measure will be specifically allocated so that the finances will be used for other matters. FAM is currently in discussions on the structure of the unit and a proposal will be presented to Prime Minister in the near future. Manchester City and the Premier League welcome a decision by an arbitration panel into the English club's alleged violations of the league's rules on associated party transactions, or APT. The panel ruled that parts of the Premier League's rules on APT were in breach of British competition law and were also unlawful because clubs were unable to comment on types of data the league would take into account. The panel also ruled that the Premier League's decision in relation to two transactions, a deal with First Abu Dhabi Bank and another with Etihad Aviation Group, both in 2023, were reached in a procedurally unfair manner and must be overturned. In a statement, City said they had succeeded with their claim, while the Premier League said the decision endorsed the overall objectives, framework and decision-making of the APT system. APT rules were designed to maintain the Premier League's competitiveness by preventing clubs from inflating the value of sponsorship deals with companies linked to their owners. Paul Pogba's doping suspension was cut from 4 years to 18 months after experts supported the French soccer player's claims of having unintentionally ingested a banned substance. The Court of Arbitration for Sport reduced the sentence last week. The 31-year-old, who has a contract with Italy's Juventus until June 2026, will be eligible to return to football in March. The France international was provisionally suspended by Italy's National Anti-Doping Organization in September last year after testing positive for DHEA, a banned substance that raises levels of testosterone. In a statement, the court said Pogba had argued that his ingestion of DHEA was not intentional and had occurred after he consumed a supplement prescribed to him by a medical doctor in Florida. His case was supported by several experts, with much of the evidence provided by Pogba unopposed. Pogba last played for Juventus in a 2-0 win at Empoli over a year ago. He had a disappointing second spell with Juve due to injuries since he returned to the Turin-based club following his departure from Manchester United on a free transfer in 2022. In tennis, world number 7 Taylor Fritz finally made it into the third round of the Shanghai Masters 2 days after his match against France's Terence Atman had been suspended because of rain. Resuming at 4-3 in the first set, Fritz defeated Atman 7-6, 7-6. Fritz, the US Open finalist, led 4-3 in the opening set against Frenchman Terence Atman when rain suspended play on Saturday at the Qingzong Forest Sports City Arena, and then washed out all matches on the outside courts until Monday. The American needed two tie breaks to see off the number 161 ranked Atman, with only one break of serve for each in the two-hour match. Fritz will play Japanese qualifier Yosuke Watanuki in the third round. Meanwhile, ninth seed Grigor Dimitrov, resuming his match with Zizou Berghs, leading by a set, prevailed 6-3, 3-6, 6-2. The number 73-ranked Belgian converted his advantage to take the second set. Dimitrov responded by breaking Berghs three times for the loss of one of his own service games to clinch the match. The Bulgarian will play Australian Alexei Popirin in the third round. And that wraps up World Today. In our top story, all parties urged to stand firm against unequal treatment of minorities. Tune in to Malaysia Tonight coming up at 8:30 p.m. on TV One and Saluran Berita RTM. From the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. I'm Otto Othman. Thanks for watching.